next session, sharing the best practices for implementation of antibiotic policy by Dr. Anita Sharma. Dr. Anita is a clinical microbiologist working at Fortis Hospital, Mohali. She's a head of Department of Laboratory Medicine and also heads the infection control program in her hospital. She also engages and collaborates with community and governmental authorities for diseases of public health importance. She's also editor, board of HISI, and also member of board of studies of a technical course at Chitkara University. She's been speaker in many national and international organizations and contributed for many chapters on antimicrobial and infection prevention. On to you, Dr. Anita.
Thank you very much. So good afternoon and good evening, everybody. And thank you, Team Kahu, for this opportunity given to talk about some best practices in the implementation of antimicrobial policy. The previous two speakers have done an excellent job in introducing the subject and setting the context. And that makes my job a little more easier when I talk about how we go about implementing these particular policies in our respective organizations. I'll be pacing my talk, under these headings. I'll just very briefly introduce the topic, spend some time on best practices, which I've categorized into these four buckets, and then very, very briefly touch implementation strategy in passing. Now, we all know with experience that implementation of antibiotic policy in a hospital is like a Herculean task. It depends upon what are the structure and the processes which are available in your hospital, what is the attitude and mindsets of the people who are working there, and above all, the organizational culture, which is defined by the commitment of the leadership of the organization. As Dr. Namita Jaggi very nicely alluded, that if your top management is supportive of the program, you would definitely find success in it. But we do see that there are certain gaps between evidence and practice, and that happens because, many a times we do not attempt to target the factors, that is the barriers and the enablers, which are critical for the successful implementation of this program. Which actually means that we sometimes lack an implicit implementation strategy. So how do we get what works to the people who need it with greater efficiency, quality, and relevant coverage? In short, how do we make our antibiotic policy implementation effective? Now, as Dr. Namita very nicely enumerated, that an antibiotic policy needs to have many aspects covered into it. It needs to talk about principles of rational antimicrobial therapy, which could include the risk stratification of the patients, the site of infection, have you sent the cultures before antimicrobials. It also needs to talk about surgical prophylaxis, standard treatment guidelines. And yes, restriction of antimicrobials is a very important concept which needs to be highlighted, along with the PK/PD of the antimicrobials. In other words, what are the dose modifications, routes, combinations, etc., etc. So when we talk about a successful implementation, probably we need to address all these components of a policy in an effective manner. Now, it has been said, and we also know that there are many areas for improvement in prescriptions. I'm not sure if you can see the slide, but the kind of opportunities for improvement, could vary from over-prescribing to overly broad-spectrum antibiotics to unnecessary antibiotics to wrong dose combinations and et cetera, et cetera. So therefore, implementation strategy or the best practices need to address all of them in a stepwise manner. So, how do we kind of, go ahead with this implementation and the strategies, the best practices I have, put across under four categories: the persuasive education, the persuasive feedback, the restriction practices, and the structural practices. So, all these buckets carry a few more, activities that we can look at. For example, the persuasive education is not just about, creating policies and making it available. It's also about how you educate in an interactive manner your stakeholders. It could be the meetings, reminders, use of checklists, champions, and we'll discuss this as we go forward. The persuasive feedback mainly hinges on the, audit and feedback methodology. The restrictive best practices talk about making it more difficult for the prescriber to order these antibiotics. And finally, it's the structural practices which mainly depend upon the diagnostic support. So first, let's take about the persuasive education. Now, the education is an extremely important and integral component of any implementation strategy. Dr. Namita already talked about it. And here, I'd just like to reemphasize that the engagement of stakeholders is of extreme importance. And it would include not just the clinicians, but the nurses, pharmacists, and the other members also. It also should address the competency building towards the antimicrobial prescription, which we sometimes lack. You know, we don't have these things happening in our organizations where we do not train our people, about the correct way of using antimicrobials. And it has been said, although there is a weak recommendation from IDSA about it, that the education definitely leads to better compliance to policy and outcome, because we all know, the mind doesn't see, the eyes don't see what the mind doesn't know. So education is extremely important. And how you go about it, like for example, if you're launching your program, the launch of policy could be a big ticket item. You involve everybody, you discuss the policy by the ones who created it, and you make it aware. At the sake of repetition, these education tools need to be made widely available and visible. They could be in the form of a booklets or pocketbooks or posters. But as my previous speaker had said, that technology can be a game changer here, and we have seen that everybody is using mobile these days. And therefore, if the policy is available as a mobile app, at the click of your button, it makes life so much simpler for everybody. So therefore, use of technology is again a very good practice in spreading the information and making the information readily accessible. So create a lot of buzz about it. The policy or launch of a policy has to have that kind of positioning in the hospital that everybody realizes it's an important aspect that they need to attend to. Checklist. Now, it's a very interesting concept and have been used in industry for a very long time, but the health industry also has taken, adopted them in a big fashion. And these checklists can be a great reminder and education tool. The important thing about checklists is that they protect us against failures and they ensure compliance every time. And moreover, when doctors and nurses create their own checklists, the consistency of care improves. So just to give an example, this hospital chain in Europe, they adopted this particular checklist as a supporting tool to improve the quality of antibiotic prescription in their hospital. The checklist was divided into two components, or rather two bundles. The first bundle was to be implemented at the time of intravenous antibiotics, at the start of it, and the second bundle was during the course of the treatment. So this first bundle was actually looking into the various metrics of good antimicrobial prescription, as was spoken about earlier, about the cultures, whether appropriate cultures were taken, whether the antibiotic was as per the policy, the dosing was correct, and the indication was specified. So and the second bundle, of course, was about looking into whether de-escalation was possible or not. And they found that the use of these checklists definitely improved the process metrics, especially with respect to the sending of cultures, both with respect to the number of cultures sent and the volume of blood included into that. And it also translated into an improved antibiotic use. So checklist, it's an educational tool. It acts as a reminder, and they definitely improve compliance in so many ways. In our hospital also, what we have done is that we have included this component in our antibiotic administration chart for the greater mindfulness of the clinician. And it also, as I said, acts as a reminder tool, and it educates also the team as they go along. Not only that, the surgical safety checklist we all use, and the antimicrobial section of the perioperative, antimicrobials form an important component of that. They act as a visual reminder, and they help the documentation, and also the ease of auditing is there. So checklist again can be used in many ways, in whatever way, and they definitely can help us out in raising the bar of education for us. Now, the second important best practice or strategy that we often have in the implementation of policy is the persuasive feedback. Now, it's an extremely important strategy to look into it, because we all know that that which is measured improves, and that which is measured and reported improves exponentially. In fact, this is the cornerstone to an effective implementation of antibiotic policy. And it includes interesting concepts like ward rounds, antibiotic timeouts, and a handshake stewardship. It definitely needs a team of committed and passionate individuals to get it going. But these audit and feedback, which can be with or without intervention, it can be of two types: prospective and retrospective. The prospective audit with feedback is typically conducted like a ward round. And here you need a trained team of maybe an ID physician or a physician with interest in infectious diseases, and also an antimicrobial stewardship team if it's available. The team does rounds, and they recommend the antimicrobials, they oversee the appropriateness of the antimicrobials, and they'll make their recommendations either in real time or in the form of a written recommendation. It is resource intensive because you need this team to be in place. However, it has a good impact, you know, wherever it is functioning appropriately. Then the second is the retrospective, where there is a record, you know, data collected and data collection is done, you know, by it could be a pharmacist or a nurse or an administrator. There it is analyzed and fed back to the prescribers on their practices. The good thing is that it can be done with limited resources also, and it usually has a good impact if it's backed by intervention. However, changing behavior is not easy, as we know, and behavioral management is one important aspect that needs to be included into it. ITSA gives us a strong recommendation, although moderate quality evidence, that these kind of interventions, they work very nicely, both in terms of reducing the you know, quantum of antimicrobials used, in making the treatment more appropriate, and in times decreasing the resistance and the cost of therapy also in a hospital. But as I said, it's not easy to get it going. So there are certain low-hanging fruits available in the policy. So what are these low-hanging fruits? You know, it could be looking at the redundant therapy, which means an undesirable combination or overlapping spectrum, or the duplication of treatment. So this is a no-brainer because we know that these are irrational combinations. They would probably figure out in the antibiotic policy as well. And therefore, they're easily to be, they can be easily looked into by the team of pharmacists and corrected and fed back to the clinicians right there. So it doesn't require too much of effort on anybody's part. It just have to probably make them make the teams aware that this is an unacceptable combination. Similarly, dose optimization, you know, the use of correct doses, duration, you know, all that stuff can also be looked into very easily. And so is the IV to oral switch, wherever the option of is available for the patient to be switched into the oral antibiotic, the availability of the drug and the patient condition. Duration and de-escalation. Now, these are a little challenging, you know, options, and it takes time. You know, it takes the confidence of the team, mutual trust to develop for us to reach. But it would be a good idea that during implementation to start from the low-hanging fruit and, you know, get success, because that motivates the team and share the success with the rest of the team members also as you go forward. So again, audit, feedback, intervene and improve. That is a strategy, and you keep on working at it like that. The cornerstone again is collecting data, information, audit and feeding it back. And now the organizations can decide what is the frequency of such audits, what is the methodology based upon the local resources available. So the audits could be in the form of a point prevalence study on prescriptions. It could be on restricted antimicrobials. It could be on de-escalation. It could be prospective audit, you know, on the various specialty guidelines. And therefore, the important thing is to keep on looking at it, you know, in whatever area that you have chosen, and feed it back to the clinicians, because data, if it's not shared and acted upon, is really of no use. An important aspect, you know, whenever you're planning an intervention during these audit and feedback round is, you know, identification of champions. Now, it has been really appreciated very well even by the Joint Commission, and where they say that an engaged clinician is the key to success of any quality improvement initiatives. So do identify specialty champions for quality improvement initiatives, and which one, how do you pick up a good champion is. They should be early adopter types, they should be a good leader, they should be trusted by their peers, and they necessarily do not have to be a senior most clinician of the unit. Sometimes even as nursing champions or even the junior doctors can be a good role model. The only thing required is they should believe and they should be committed to it. And the champions, what they do is they identify the local barriers and they provide solutions, because they're working with the team, they understand them better, and therefore they can, you know, properly initiate these changes easier in a better fashion. They can devote time to learn about the new stewardship or the newer antimicrobial information that could be available. They may themselves conduct local either audits and feedback at the unit regarding the antimicrobial prescribing practices, and they liaise with the AMS team for intervention. So in short, you know, what they have what we call as an IKEA effect. We love it more if we made it. So they have a better ownership, and we definitely see such changes, you know, faster in such areas. And that has been our experience also. For example, we had a major problem with the surgical prophylaxis in two of the major surgical specialties, the orthopedics and the CABG service. And it was basically the improvement initiative in these two units were driven through by their own anesthesiologist, who took it upon themselves, and in collaboration with the AMS team, we've made a tremendous success where earlier the compliance was less than 20% to both choice and time and duration. It's now more than 90%. So the champion, is a very good idea whenever you have an initiative plan. Another interesting, concept in audit and feedback, prospective audit and feedback strategy is the handshake stewardship. Now, this is something like it says the researchers of this particular concept. They said that if you meet and greet the person who's prescribing, you're trying to influence. It's by actually having a face-to-face discussion, you generally have a better success rate in convincing them based on data risk that they may not have known. So it's all about mutual trust and personal contact, and it's something like you see deals over handshake, and that's why it's called as a handshake stewardship. Now, therefore, it's an extended and unique derivative of prospective audit and feedback, and it's characterized by lack of restriction and prior authorization. It typically involves a shared review of all prescribed antimicrobials by a physician and pharmacist, and it's done at a two-point review that is either 24 hours, and one at 24 hours and one at 48 or 72 hours. It's based on daily rounding in-person approach, and it has been found to significantly reduce the antimicrobial use. So therefore, these roundings have been found to be highly effective, sustainable. They offer plenty of opportunity to teach, and they teach the entire team, not just the person who made the call. And therefore, it also gives an opportunity for the team to have a second look at the diagnosis. So it's said that many times it can also probably address possible diagnostic errors which may have been missed by the first team. However, the important thing to remember here is that the communication skills and relationship building are important, and it can only work if there is enough trust built between the two teams who are working on it. And the clinicians like it better. And in this survey that they did, they found that the formal scheduled antimicrobial rounds with face-to-face interactions was preferred by the clinicians over the written suggestions. So therefore, they found favor about these very formal, defined rounds that happen jointly in the wards. And one more concept which should we all should be looking into is the antibiotic time out. It's like a self-assessment stewardship, and it's something the time out we do at the time of surgeries, we pause and reflect. Similarly, for stewardships also, they say that you must use this trigger tool to stop and reassess antibiotic therapy at 72 hours. Because at 72 hours, we have some more clinical information available with us with respect to the bug. We may have some assessment of the clinical response, the microbiological data regarding organism or its susceptibility. And therefore, at this time, the physician should answer these questions: that does this patient have an infection that will respond to antibiotics? Do I need to continue, escalate, de-escalate? And if that be the case, is the patient on right antibiotic with respect to dose and route? So basically, it addresses the de-escalation, dose modification, and duration aspects of the antimicrobial prescription. Even in England also, they have taken it up in a big way, and they have specially used antibiotic timeout checklist for this purpose, which also defines the instructions for the timeout given. And in case you don't want to add another checklist to your documentation, you can also add it to your antimicrobial prescription chart, as we have done in our hospital. So therefore, again, this is out there for the clinicians to look into when they are prescribing and reviewing the antibiotics at various stages of patient management. The benefits: it captures and controls attention, enhances informed and deliberate reasoning, redirects decision direction by making inappropriate antimicrobial discontinuation easier, fosters autonomy because the clinicians themselves are taking that decision, and it has been found to be as effective as restrictive measures. The disadvantage is that the clinician may not de-escalate, left alone to themselves, many a times. To sum up, audit and feedback methodology or the best practice increases visibility, maintains prescriber autonomy, and the audit and frequency methodology can be based on the local resources. Disadvantages being it's a labor intensive and it's less likely to achieve immediate and significant reductions as compared to restriction practices. The results will take a little longer, but ultimately you'll get there. And prescribers, as I said, are less likely to change if the patient is doing well. The third component, which is really talked about, is about the restriction practices. And if you can get this going, this gets you the fastest results in terms of a judicious and appropriate usage of antimicrobials. And restrictive practices majorly include formulary restriction, pre-authorization, a compulsory order form sets, automatic stop orders, and cascade reporting from the microbiology lab. Talking about formulary restriction and pre-authorization, you need to have certain conditions fulfilled before you can actually get this going. As has been said earlier, you need to have a list of restricted antimicrobials defined and available in the policy and be known to everybody. And these drugs could be anything that your organization have decided, but typically may include something like colistin, penem, linezolid, or any other antibiotic that you've chosen to look into. You must also specify the indication for use, because, you know, unless it's very clarified to the clinicians, and you know, it may become a little difficult. Then it should also have an approval system that how do we authorize the you know, prescription, the indenting of these antimicrobials. Is there going to be a manual approval? Is there a system generated approval? And this approval or restriction has to be backed up by an expert advice, preferably 24/7, which many a times could be difficult to get by. Now, this expert advice again could be through a team of individuals, or it could be an automated system as well. So, you know, hospitals may work at mandatory justification at indenting, but many hospitals work at, you know, probably putting these kind of restrictions at after first dose or after 48 hours of empirical pending approval. Also, as a best practice, system generated reminders can be sent to prescribers to look into the justification, which has to be approved by a system. So again, it requires a very strong support system in the hospital to get it going, and the use of IT can be of immense help in making it smooth and effective. The benefit is that it reduces start of inappropriate antibiotics, optimizes empirical choice, and definitely is compliant with the local policy. It influences future prescribing practices and improves outcomes with respect to cost and resistance. The disadvantage being that it packs use of restricted agents only, and sometimes we may have the squeeze the balloon effect. If your restricted antimicrobials decrease in their consumption, someone else would probably increase. So one has to look into that also. There's a loss of prescriber autonomy, which is not sometimes appreciated by the clinicians. Also, it may delay time to therapy for patients at times, if in case there is the process is not very robust. The effectiveness also depends on the skills of the approver, and it can be real-time resource intensive. The another concept and restriction is the automated stop orders, and it can work very well where we have situations where we have defined drugs, doses and days defined, and for example duration of surgical prophylaxis, so it's very well defined, and therefore it can work like a single after single dose or 24 hours the antibiotics will not be prescribed and one will not be able to indent it for the patient. So therefore the automatic stop orders along with educational initiative, and they have definitely improved the compliance to surgical prophylaxis and reduce the prolonged duration, but may result in unintentional treatment interruption due to failure of providers to reorder an antimicrobial medication where required. So one has to be mindful of it, that you know there has to be a system or the process available to ensure that the people or the patient needing the antibiotics are not denied because of these restrictive orders. And the last bit of it is the cascade reporting in microbiology. Dr. Balaji has already talked about it, and it has supported very well. It says out of sight, out of mind. When that be the situation, the clinicians will probably not report or not give the higher-end antibiotic microbials if they have not been reported by the lab. So lab must follow these CLSI guidelines and report the antimicrobials only as first, second, third, and the higher antimicrobials only to be reported if the options are not available for the first-line ones. And this also is a very good best practice, and it has decreased the antimicrobial use by the clinical fraternity. And the last part of it is the use of practices like diagnostics, stewardship, or structural practices. And I will not really touch upon it because I believe the next speaker is going to be talking about it. So, but the use of point of care diagnostic systems, is extremely important. And if you can get it going, you know, it can reduce a lot of irrational prescriptions, especially with respect to the viral diseases where antibiotics get pumped into it because we do not have an appropriate diagnosis quickly available on time. However, these are a little expensive as of now, and how we can include them, how we can include these best practices in a routine implementation needs to be watched for in times to come. Finally, when we talk about the implementation of the best practices, it's not what you do, but it's how you do it. And here a lot of other factors come into play, and you have to really come to the implementation science of it. Start in a stepwise manner, address the low-hanging fruits first, build on the existing structure, maximum teamwork and encourage champions. So these are some of the quality improvement tools that we can use. Always do it in the DMAC, use Six Sigma tools to get this going. It has to be a multidisciplinary and a multimodal approach involving pharmacists, nursing, microbiology, the infectious disease and the unit champions. Like any other quality improvement initiative, whatever intervention you planned, it can be done in stages of pre-intervention, intervention and post, where you do a gap analysis, you put some intervention, you audit feedback, and then consolidate and come up with even more best practices, what you can find in your own respective organization. And the key to success is monitor. And good data integrity is of extreme importance. There's no point in just either not collecting it well or not presenting it well if you have to bring about a change. In the end, I would just like to say that one size does not fit all. We have huge problems and immense possibilities available to us. We need local solutions to global problems because each hospital will have its own challenges of its own problem with respect to bugs, with respect to resources, with respect to the individuals who are present there. And therefore, if you have to ensure a good implementation, it needs not only commitment, it needs action for policy and practice, it needs tracking, it needs education expertise, but above all, it needs a good support from the hospital leadership. Behavior has to be addressed, and it's again a different topic altogether, and this is something we all struggle with, and we all need to equip ourselves better. We need to make ourselves more competent in probably these kind of social sciences, engage with other organizations to understand how best we can do that. So and while we do along, it's also about adaption and the adaptation and the innovation that you can do in your own respective unit. With that, I come to the end of this talk. Thank you again. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Anita. It was fantastic. I also agree with you when you say that what is measured improves, but what is measured and reported, improves exponentially. Because I think when we started antimicrobial stewardship program, we started with very basic steps like reporting what they were prescribing and also introducing justification forms. So that itself brought a lot of changes. So I think a small step towards this in the same direction will make a great improvement in future. We have one question for you from Dr. Aditi. She asks, what is the right time for de-escalation? Is it when you get antibiotic susceptibility pattern or when the patient is improving on current empirical therapy? What is the minimum time for current antibiotic empirical therapy?
So, as you just said, that it can never be based upon the laboratory report only. So you have to amalgamate the clinical profile of the patient and the laboratory picture. And we often say that whenever you send labs, some of it would be back by 48 to 72 hours. So that would be a good time to take stock of your condition of the patient. And that is what is also being talked about in the antibiotic timeouts. You could choose 48 hours or 72 hours, but by our experience, by 72 hours, most of the investigations that you have sent, you would have got it back, whatever you started as empirical would have had some time to take its effect, and I think that would be a good time to take stock of your de-escalation or whatever else modification you may choose to decide.
Yeah, 72 hours is an ideal time, I think. We do not have any other questions. Thank you, Dr. Anita. It was a very crisp and nice presentation.